I mean, you've been around, I mean, so many wonderful people in your career.
Oh, my gosh.
I mean, we can go down the list of so many people, but I really want to touch on one individual because he's very special to our hometown of Poway.
Tony Gwynn.
Tony Gwynn.
Of course.
You know,
of course.
An all-time great. I mean, there's so many great stories about Tony. Can you share a few?
It was just, I don't know how I ever got in that position. I got in that position because before he became a Padre, he was an Aztec. And I'm at basketball practice in 1978, and they would not let him play baseball for the Aztecs. Tim Vesey was the coach, and he would not let Tony play two sports. And that made Tony crazy because Tony was great. I didn't say good. Great in basketball. Still holds the all-time assist record at San Diego State. You can look it up. And it's been a long time since he played. And I introduced myself. And he said, yeah, I watched you on television. And I said to him, well, maybe we can be friends anyway. And he laughed at Tony Gwynn laugh. That was the first time I heard the Tony Gwynn laugh that I played at his memorial that I was voicing.
Yeah.
I was going to say, you don't MC or something like that. And I'm certainly not a minister. No. But that was a moment where I was totally out of my element. I don't do funerals. I don't do memorials. I don't know what I'm going to do. And we start out with a releasing of 19 doves going 19. To the heavens. And perfect. I'm trying to hold it together. And I look down at the first row at the, in the seats down from the platform I'm on. And I see Alicia crying so hard, so hard. So I walk off the podium and walk down and squat in front of her and hold her hands and whatever. And I'm just lost. I'm just lost. How am I going to get through this? How am I going to even mention his name? What am I going to do? I love this guy. And I went back up, and then it Petco, of course, and the people in the upper stands, upper level, down the left field line, when I paused, I could hear, Tony, 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 building and building and building. And then I thought, this is not a funeral. This is literally a celebration of one of the great men we've ever known. Mm-hmm. And we're not going to turn it into a memorial or a funeral. The funeral's later. And then I was okay. Then I was like, okay, now you're just emceeing something for a bunch of Padre fans who loved him just like you love him. Now get out there and do this. And I was able to maintain and get through that thanks to the Padre fans who were doing that. It made it seem like it's a ball game, and it's Tony, Tony, every time he comes to the plate. But to know someone like that, my gosh, it was shy, so shy. And I used to see that transformation to become Mr. Padre, where you need some quotes, go to Tony Gwynn. You need somebody to fill your notebook up with stories, go to Tony Gwynn. And he was always there for everybody, with his comment that by the time I leave this world, I want everybody who wants a Tony Gwynn autograph to have a Tony Gwynn autograph.
Wow.
That's the way he was. And I don't know if I can tell this or not, but Junior told me this story fairly recently. I never heard it before. But when he would go home and he would drive by this bus stop, even as a young man, and there was this older guy waiting for the bus day after day after day after day. And Tony had seen him for like 20 years. And he finally pulled over with Junior in the car. And he said, hey, buddy. And the guy comes over and he says, Mr. Gwynn, good to see you, man. How you doing? Hey, Tony, I love you since you were playing at Poly and high school and in Long Beach. Wow. Always loved you. And he said, what do you? I've seen you at the bus since I was 15. How come you don't have a car? How come you don't drive? I don't have enough money. I don't have a car. And you've been taking the bus every day? Yes. Get in the car. I'll take you to work. But first, we're going to a car dealer.
Really?
And bought him a car.
Awesome.
I never heard that story. That's Tony Gwynn.
Wow.
That's Tony Gwynn. And we didn't see another 1,500 things like that that we never heard about, that I never heard about, as close as I thought I was to him. And that shy little kid, I remember the first time he beat Texas El Paso when the Aztecs went in the whack and beat him with a 15-foot jump shot. And I had him on the post-game show, first time, first interview. It was deadly. It was deadly. I would ask something, he'd give me a two-word answer. And I thought, well, next question. Wait a minute, Tony, I got to get out my dental tools and pull some teeth here and give me a longer answer. And I would tease him about that for the next 20 years, about the dental tools, and he knew exactly what I was talking about because he became so eloquent, so loquacious, so unbelievable, and he thought it was his duty to do that. He didn't want to do the interviews. He didn't want to be Mr. Padre. He didn't want to, you know, show up anybody on his team because they said, no, I ain't talking. And Tony would not say that to someone. He just wouldn't. And other times when he was really busy because he had to do what he had to do. This is the time that I shag. This is the time that I practice this and that and run sprints. Whatever it is, I don't have time. I'm sorry. And he would always feel bad about that. Even if it was somebody from a weekly out in Alpine and he'd never met him before. And then when he got done, he would go to that person and say, okay, now I have time. And he'd sit down and he'd fill this guy's notebook with 30 minutes of great, great stuff. Oh. What a gift from God he was to all of us.
And then he coached at his alma mater back at San Diego State. And I've seen videos of him working with the younger players, like little leaguers.
He loved that.
Just the art of hitting.
Because everybody thought, well, he's just doing this. And he would come to me and say, these people think I'm just using San Diego State as a stepping stone. I don't care about the majors. I want to teach.
Yeah.
You can't teach some guy, you know, who's been doing it the same way and so forth. Batting coaches, please. These kids, I can actually make an impact, and that's what I want to do. No, he's going to be a GM. You know, he didn't like to travel. He's afraid of flying. He always was afraid of flying. So he didn't want to be a coach that's on the team bus and team plane and fly, but a general manager doesn't have to do that as much. And so they said, oh, no, he's going to be a general manager. And I'd go to Tony and say, did you read so-and-so saying you're going to be a GM? He'd like, I don't understand it. Theodore, he always called. I told Junior that how much I missed that. And now when I see Junior, he says, Theodore!
Right on.
In that same voice. And I'm in love, man. I just think it's so wonderful. And he was always saying, I'm an Aztec for life. That's not just a phrase they use out there in Montezuma Mesa. Mm-hmm. I'm an Aztec for life, Ted. And you know I'm not using this. I'm going to be there. And he would have been there to this day if he hadn't gone at 54, for heaven's sakes. And that's the way he was.